Okay, hello students, and welcome to this fifth lecture on the finite volume method. So today I'm going to talk about a few issues regarding the selection of mesh for any finite volume solver, and then we'll also look at solution of developing the discretization equation for non-Cartesian coordinates. So let's start with this aspect of meshing, and in that I'm going to talk about these geometric considerations. And by geometric considerations, I basically mean where do we put the location of the CV faces. So far in our entire treatment, we have not spoken about this key aspect. Okay, we said it's not important so far. I mean, till the last lecture, what we have discussed, I had been saying that it's not very important where you put the CV faces. But now let's look at identifying good strategies of putting the CV faces. So the two strategies that I can say broadly, okay, one would be basically if you place the face which is midway between grid points. Okay, so I'm going to call this as option A. And the second strategy that I'm going to talk about is placing these grid points at the centers of the CV, which let me say is option B. Okay, now the two of these are actually very different, and let me show you how. So let's look at option A first, or strategy A. We are saying that we will place the faces between or midway between grid points. So we first, it's this broadly or in a more layman manner, we can say that this is essentially a strategy where you choose a grid and then you draw the control volume faces. So how does it happen? So let's say we look at the 1D problem. So 1D problem, let's say this is a one-dimensional domain. Okay, we have boundary end nodes or boundary nodes, and then we have some internal nodes which I have denoted by this green color. Okay, and now what I'm saying is we'll choose, so the grid is chosen, let's say this is the way in some problem we've chosen the grid to be of this type, which appears to be non-uniform, and now we draw the control volume faces. So the control volume faces would mean that I'm going to now put control volume faces exactly halfway between or midway between the grid points. So for the first control volume face, it's going to be midway between these two points, which is this dotted orange line. Okay, and this essentially has that, let's say this distance and this distance. So let's say this, I say this delta x1 and this is delta x1, so they are equal. Okay, then for the next one, we can now see that this distance and this distance, right, this is, let's say, delta x2, that is also equal. And so we can continue this. So as I've shown, the third one, okay, this one, the third one, this distance is equal to this distance. And then the fourth one will mean that this distance is the same as that distance. And finally, of course, we can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So those two distances are also the same. Now this is how it comes up in 1D. What about 2D? So in a 2D situation, I've actually deliberately taken a non-uniform grid. So let's say this, so the white lines denote the grid lines, basically the lines at the intersection of, you know, two families of lines, you get a grid point. So we have x equal to constant lines, and then we have y equal to a constant lines. And so at the intersection, we have these green color grid points. And now we have to choose the volume, or we have to choose the face which is exactly halfway or midway between grid points. So we can draw this orange line which goes halfway between any two grid points, right, like that. And then we can draw these orange grid lines again, or orange face lines again, which will go halfway between the faces. Now if we do this, right, we can see that this is essentially one representative control volume that we get in this problem. Okay, because this is the volume that is bound by these four faces. So the point P, which is a grid point, is actually somewhere there. We can now locate the north face, the south face, the east face, the west face. The grid point to the left becomes west, the grid point to the right becomes east, bottom is south and top is north. Now let's look at this grid point, this arrangement, and I'm sure you would have already made out some inferences about this, but let's just discuss about one key aspect. First of all, which is what the question says, is the grid point P at the geometric center of the CV? So now you can see that this grid point P is not at the geometric center, right? It is actually slightly displaced in general, right? Because in this case, if you look at the distances, we have this distance, or let me say this distance and this distance. So this is delta XE and this is going to be delta XW, and the half distance, basically this half distance will just be delta XW by 2, and this is going to be delta XE by 2. So in general, delta XE is not equal to delta XW. Okay, so this would be an arrangement which may actually lead to such a problem that the grid point P may not actually be at the geometric center. So please remember this, we'll come back to this point again. Now let's look at option B. Now option B is different in the sense that here, instead of placing the faces at the midway between, you know, two grid points, we actually place the grid points at the center of the CV. So the difference is here in terms of implementation, that we first have to look at the domain and we first divide the domain into control volumes. Okay, so we have well-defined control volume boundaries. And the second step then takes us to placing a grid point at the geometric center of the CV. So let's do it. Let's look two examples to illustrate this point. So this is a 1D example. Now let's again say that this is a problem where I've been given, or I know that the domain is this one-dimensional domain, okay, and there are some boundary conditions which I'm not very concerned about at this moment, okay. So we first split the domain into volumes. So we have split the domain here into, so this becomes, let's say, volume 1, this is volume 2, this is volume 3, then you have volume 4 and volume 5. So I've split the entire domain into 5 volumes. Now I'm going to place the grid point at the geometric center of the CV, which essentially means that I have put one grid point here, right at the geometric center, the second one is here, right? The third one is here, fourth is here, fifth is here. Now by placing it at the geometric center, what we are saying is that now the distances, so let's say this is delta x1, this is also delta x1, then we have this distance being delta x2, and so is this distance, and then I can say delta x3, delta x3, delta x4, delta x4, and so on and so forth. Okay, now how does it work out in 2D? So 2D is, again, I look at the domain first. So in this case, my domain is, let's say, this box in which I want to solve this problem. I have first split this domain into a certain number of volumes, and which these volumes could be of, you know, unequal size. We don't really concern ourselves with that right now. Okay. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to denote, or I'm going to find out the grid point at the geometric center of the CV, or of these CVs. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a vertical line and a horizontal line, which is bisecting the horizontal, or which is a geometric, which will go through the geometric center of each CV, and then the horizontal line will also go through the geometric center in the horizontal direction. So the intersection of these lines inside the CV will actually give me the grid points. So once you go through this exercise, again we have a representative control volume. We have a control volume which has a grid point P, it has neighbors E, W, N, and S, it has faces, you know, which we denote by E, W, N, and S. And now what can we say about the distances, the key aspect that we are trying to explain here. Okay, so what are we saying now about the distances? Let's see. So we can denote that this control volume has, let's say, a size of delta y, and I mean height of delta y, and let's say length of delta y and width of delta x. So meaning now with the geometric center approach, what we are saying is that this control volume or this point P is exactly halfway from either of the control volume faces. And similarly, I can say this is going to be delta y by 2, and this is also delta y by 2. And now if you look at the overall dimensions, let's say we can choose the distance of point P from point E, which is what we write as delta XE, and distance of point P from point W, which we write as delta XW. So we now know that when we come to this question, that is delta XE equal to delta XW and delta XN, delta YN is equal to delta YS. Is that true? So the answer is no, in general. That this is not going to be true in general. It can be true, okay, which is a very specific case, which is this case that I have now put up on the screen. This is going to be true especially if you have a uniform grid, in which case both approach A and approach B become the same. They will give you the same grid arrangement, but it would not necessarily be true, which we already can see. In fact, if you look at this side, okay, you can see that the distance of point P from point S is actually delta Y S, right? But the distance of point S from, or this node S from the face S, this distance here, right, that is not delta Y S by 2. Okay, so, oh, in fact, I should say this as delta YS. Okay, now next question comes in: are there any advantages of each of these methods, or do we have anything to gain by choosing one of these two methods? So if you look at it carefully now, if I go back to option A, which is this option, okay, because the grid point P is exactly, you know, is equidistant from points P and W, you may now think that approximating the gradient at point W, remember we need to calculate dt dx, let's say, at W, or dt dx at E, right? These two quantities will have to be computed. So having point, or having the face W exactly halfway between W and P, would actually mean that if I use Taylor series, just very simply, if I write this in Taylor series form, I can prove that these two expressions will actually give me second order accuracy at this point W, let me write this here just to make it very clear. What I'm saying is, if I say dt dx at W, which I'm going to approximate as t p minus tw by delta xw, I am saying this will be with second order accuracy. That's what it seems to show, right? Just by using Taylor series. So option A, on the face of it, appears to have a greater accuracy in calculating heat flux. Okay, and that, what I'm saying is, you should look at a basic explanation using Taylor series. Okay, Taylor series, essentially, if you use the Taylor series expansion, we can show that dt dx at any phase, let's say W phase, is TP minus TW by delta XW plus a second order accurate term. But what about option B? Now, option B will actually say that if you apply Taylor series now, especially when you say that, let's say we have to calculate the flux here, and you apply Taylor series, and you know that point E or this phase E is not equidistant away from point P and point E, so you may not actually get second order accuracy. Okay, so it may appear that option B is not accurate in terms of calculating fluxes, but where option B wins over is that it's more accurate, you know, if you assume that temperature of the point P, which we are trying to now calculate, when we have been making this assumption in terms of calculating certain variables, for example, calculating the source term or calculating the transient term. We have assumed so far, if you remember or if you recall, that we said that temperature at this grid point sort of represents the entire temperature of the cell or of the volume. So having the point P at geometric center would mean, or would actually be a better approximation that way to denote temperature, or to denote that this temperature P is, you know, is spread over this entire volume. If you look at option A, remember this volume? Option A, the temperature P is here, and now we are saying that P is actually closer to some faces, it's farther away from some faces. So there, this can actually be a bigger problem, where the temperature may actually be, you know, that this approximation may not be a good approximation, especially when you have a very skewed cell, or a cell which is, you know, or a volume which is maybe has a very longer dimension, or has a longer length in one dimension and a shorter length in the other dimension. So that this is where this option B seems to score better. Okay, so the reason why we are saying that this is it's more accurate to assume that TV prevails over the entire CV in this approach is because our point P is at the geometric center of the cell, or if you want to call it, of how we've been saying it as control volume. Now let's look at few other problems with option A. So let's say we have this arrangement. Again, I'm reproducing from what we have done earlier. Let's say this is the arrangement. We have the distances given here. Okay. And what we are now going to say is that in this case, remember in option A, we said that we first choose the grid points, then put the face halfway between the grid points. So that is the reason I have denoted here that the length, for example, here is delta y n, and the distance of the face from the grid point is delta y n by 2, and this entire length is delta y s, and the distance of the point P from the face is delta y s by 2, and same thing we have done for delta x e and delta x w. Now let's look at the calculation of this integral, okay, which appears in the 2D diffusion equation. So we have d by dy of k dt dy dy dx integrated from south to north face and west to east face, right? And now what we can do is when we integrate, we get this dy, and this dy basically will give us k dt dy at the north face minus k dt dy at the south face integrated over the east to west faces, right? So we have to compute this in function at the north face and integrate from west to east. Similarly, this function which appears here, right, on the south face from west to east. Now in the till the last lecture, what I had told you is that we can assume that this function, to simplify this further, we can assume that this function, let's say k dt dy, is constant over the entire face, right? So let's say k dt dy at n, I'm saying, is constant over the entire face. By assuming it to be a constant, we could write this as, if you recall, we could write this as, let's say, k dt dy on the north face integral from west to east dx could be written as kn. So kn, we could write this as n minus tp by delta yn into delta x. Okay, this is what we had done. Now, so basically, this is what I'm saying, that we can assume, if we want to assume, or we had been assuming, that this is how we will simplify this integral, okay? By assuming that this function k dt dy is actually constant over the entire phase. Now, what this k dt dy essentially is, it is sort of like a flux, right? It's minus k dt dy. So we can say flux, let's say flux leaving on the north face will be minus k dt dy, right? The flux component along y. So this is what this flux is. That is a flux leaving, right? Now, what we are saying is that if you assume this flux to be constant over the entire phase, this can actually be a bad approximation if the phase itself, if the phase here, right, if we talk in terms of, you know, what's leaving, if this point P is not at the geometric center of the volume, we will actually have a bias in our calculation, or we'll be tilting the calculation in a certain way. But if this point P was at the center, then we can actually, to a greater accuracy or to a greater satisfaction, we can say that the point P represents the average behavior of the cell. So this approximation here will make more sense. Okay, so it is not a good approximation, especially this type, when delta x e and delta x w are not equal, and similarly when delta y n is not equal to delta y s. But in option B, if you see now, right, delta x e and delta x w will be the same, right? So if you see now, because it's at the, I mean, it's this whole idea that I should not say delta x e equal to delta x w, but I should say that now that the point P is at the geometric center, okay? So point P being at the geometric center would mean that it represents that the distance, so I should not put it this way, I should actually say, let me change this. So what I should say is option B will have E and W to be at equal distance from point P. And so it would be a better approximation to assume that the flux is represented by the average value, or the value at that midpoint. Now, one more aspect that we can discuss is about convenience. Now, let's talk about convenience of A over B or B over A. And to explain that, I'm taking this example, which has been taken from the book by Patankar, which talks about, let's say, a sudden change in boundary condition. So let's say we have an adiabatic wall up to a certain point in the domain, and then we have an isothermal wall. So adiabatic wall will basically mean that dt dy is zero, and isothermal basically means that the temperature is, let's say, some given temperature Ts, some surface temperature, or let me say T surface. Okay. Now, if you look at option B, which talks about first defining your control volumes and then deciding on the grid points, in this case with option B, we can actually choose the control volumes in such a way that they are actually on either side of the discontinuity. So for example, the discontinuity happens at this point where the temperature character would suddenly change. It will go from dt dy of 0 to a fixed temperature, right? So I can define the control volumes in such a way that this discontinuity is not reflected, especially when we do the calculation. So if I look at this, let's say this cell, it will contain the same boundary condition over the entire phase. And similarly, this cell will contain the same boundary condition over the entire phase. Okay. So what I mean by this, that is that we have these CVs which have been designed to avoid discontinuity over the CV. So option B gives us this convenience as well. Okay, so this is one aspect. Now we talk about boundary treatments. Now, given A or B, you know, how do we implement boundary conditions? So in option A, if you now recall when we looked at one of the earlier lectures about boundary condition implementation, where we have basically option A is essentially taking out grid points and then defining control volumes. So option A will essentially require you to have a half control volume near the boundary. And this is something that we've already discussed, and I'm not going to repeat this again. But let's look at option B, because this is a neat new treatment which I'm taking up in this lecture. Option B will mean that you first define control volumes and then you define grid points at the geometric center. Now what it means is that if I look at this point P, for it the boundary point will be here, but there is no control volume here, because this is the control volume phase. So it is as good as saying that you have a point B which is enclosed in a zero thickness control volume. So we can say point B is enclosed in a zero thickness CV, or a volume CV or zero volume. Okay, so what we do in option B is that we first place the boundary grid points on the face, and then we have to apply the boundary condition, which technically will not require any special treatment. So let me show you how. So let's say we are trying to look at this integral at the point P, or in this volume W to E, okay, and we write this as k dt dx E minus k dt dx W. Now at the east face, it's fairly simple. I can write the first integral as ke into t minus tp by delta xe, where delta xe is this distance. But what about the left face? Now k minus k dt dx at w is essentially the flux. So I'm just replacing that with plus q double dash p. Now here comes the best part. If the flux is given at this point, at point B, I can straight away put that flux here and I'm done, right? I can straight away plug in this flux value if it was given. So if it's constant, it straight away goes in and you have solved you have written the entire equation in this form. But in case the flux is not given, but rather let's say the temperature was given, even then it's not going to be a problem, because then you know that the distance here, I could write this as delta xw, and I could then write, if the temperature TB was given, I could write minus k dt dx, let's say at w, to be minus kw into tp minus tw by, and actually I should not say tw, but I should say tb. So that will also be taken care of. So TB then gets imposed as a boundary condition in the flux expression, where of course the delta XW is much smaller than delta XE. Okay. Lastly, if a mixed type boundary condition was given, even then it's not an issue, because now if Q double dash B is given to be, you know, H T infinity minus TB, which means that there's a fluid here, which has some heat transfer coefficient and let's say some temperature T infinity, then I could write Q double dash B to be H T infinity minus TB, and again the boundary temperature then comes in as an unknown, which you have to compute, by the way, but it's still fairly easy and doable. So this option B is actually it has the same level of complexity in implementing boundary conditions, except it now does not require you to have a half control volume to be able to impose these boundary conditions. Okay, so having covered this, let's discuss one key aspect about implementation, or you know, developing discretization equations for other coordinate system which are non-Cartesian. And what I'm now going to show you is that this method that we have developed so far can actually also be used without too many difficulties for a grid with any orthogonal coordinate system. So to show you this, let me choose a cylindrical coordinate system, and I'm not doing the spherical part. I'm leaving that to you as an exercise to develop. But let's look at this problem where, let's say, we have a solid cylinder, okay, and let's say there's a fluid around it, and we want to calculate the rate of, so the solid cylinder could be, let's say, at a given temperature, or could be radiating some flux, you know, it could be giving out heat flux. So whatever that could be, that's immaterial right now. But let's say this, we want to calculate how the heat is flowing through the cylinder to the outer fluid, to the surrounding fluid. Okay. And so we're looking at heat conduction equation in polar coordinates. So what we have is essentially the cylinder, around that are these concentric lines, which essentially denote the lines of constant radius. And then we have these radially outward lines, which are actually lines of constant theta, angular position theta. Okay, so theta r is essentially our coordinate system here, and we are doing it in 2D, so I'm not showing you the z component here. So if I magnify this portion, and so the intersection of these two lines will actually give us the grid points. So if I magnify this portion here, I can see that grid point P is here, N is here, S is here, E is here, and W is here. And now we are doing it in polar coordinates, so I need to appropriately define the control volume. So in this case, the distance of point P from point N would be delta Rn. Remember, because that's a radial distance, so that is in terms of N, or in terms of R, and delta Rs would be on the south side. But in terms of angular location, the angular separation, now we will have delta theta E from P to E, and delta theta W from W to P. And this control volume that we can now define here, right, with the faces given as N, S, and E, and W, small n, small e, small s, small w, their size, this volume, the size of the control volume will be in terms of some distance delta r and some angular, you know, coordinate delta theta. Okay, so let's pick up the governing equation, which is this is the transient heat conduction equation with some source term s. Now what we can do is we can integrate this equation in this hatched portion, or in this highlighted region. So if I integrate this equation now from N to S, W to E, and T plus 2T plus delta T, the left hand side is rho C dT dT into dT. And now you have to understand that this volume, the volume of the hatched portion, the volume of this element would essentially be R into d theta into dr. So that is what has been plugged in here. That is the elemental volume. So now we see this on the left hand side, and the right hand side will again have the same volume and temperature integrals, or the time integrals. And now let's look at simplification. So the first integral here, this will just give us rho c into dt. Dt dt will cancel. So we'll have, and remember, we are using we're making this assumption that the temperature prevails over the entire CV. So this volume will basically just come out as delta V. That would be integrated, and you'll have Tp minus Tp naught on the left hand side. What about the right hand side? Now what we can see is that this R and this R will cancel. So this dr essentially will take away this dr, and you'll have an Rk dt dr computed at the north face minus Krk dt dr computed at the south face. So this is the integrand. This integrand gets computed, and now don't get confused with N and S. Remember, R is essentially the sort of like a counterpart for Y in this geometry, and theta becomes a counterpart for X. Okay, so we'll have that into delta theta delta T plus the second integral. If you look now again, this R gets cancelled here. Okay, this d theta takes this d theta out, so we'll have K by R. This integrand, so will come as K by R d theta at east minus K by R d theta at W into delta R, which comes from here, into delta T. And finally, we do the source term linearization here. So we get SC plus SPTP into delta V into delta T. Okay? Where again, I'm saying delta V here is the volume, the elemental volume of this small control volume, which you can easily integrate. So from W to E and S to N of R dr d theta, if you integrate that, you will get this number, okay? And which now I can show you is going to be half Rn plus Rs into delta R into delta theta. Because remember, we have Rn square minus Rs square to be Rn minus Rs into, Rn plus Rs. And if you look at my geometry again, Rn minus Rs, Rn minus Rs is essentially delta R. So that's what we get here. Okay, we get a delta R. Now in general, you know, some people may have thought that this volume delta V should have been equal to Rp into delta theta into delta R. But that is only true if P was at the midpoint of N and S. Okay, and we are actually developing a system which is, can be used for both option, the two types of grids, A or B. So it need not necessarily always be true, but it would be preferred. If you use option B, then definitely it would be this number. So now finally, what do we have? Now we have rho C into delta V. We can divide the entire equation by delta T. This delta T gets, you know, divides the entire equation. So we have delta T here. And then this is just a matter of collecting all the terms together and rearranging. So we have APTP to be AET plus AWTW plus ANTN plus ASTS plus B, and where I can now write all these coefficients. So B has the constant part of the source term plus the initial condition, which is basically the initial condition for starting this specific iteration. So from going from T to T plus delta T, AP naught is the same, AN and AS and AE and AW get modified depending on the choice of the coordinate system, and then AP is also something similar, with SP being understood to be negative. So we are using a negative or a negative linearization of the source term. Okay, so this is what you should get. So now what I'm going to show you as a demonstration is how to use this cylindrical coordinate system for solving a heat diffusion equation. So that would be by next demonstration for this course. And from there on, we will actually move into solving convection and diffusion type problems.